This evening, I'm going to be talking, the talk I've titled is Banditry, Spanish Trade Caravans, and the Environment, How Commerce Fueled the Disruption of Spanish Authority in Texas, 1808 to 1813. And really, so a little bit of background about how I got onto this subject. When I started at Texas Christian, I didn't know what I wanted to write a dissertation on. I thought I wanted to write it about Apalachicola and Prospect Bluff. Well, two books came out in 2 years. All right, you got to find something else. So my advisor told me, he said, why don't you look up this neutral ground in Western Louisiana, East Texas. And so started fumbling through it, kind of reading stuff, and I realized that the most recent dissertation that was published as a full-length article was in 1943. So I thought, oh, okay. Now, since there was one other dissertation, but it took a dure perspective, long history of the Louisiana-Texas borderland. And so I looked at the earlier work and thought, okay, I want to bring the focus back to those years from 1803 to 1821. So from Louisiana Purchase to the implementation of the Transcontinental Treaty. And so I'll start with an anecdote that kind of fueled my interest in banditry. So on the 22nd of February, 1812, a Spanish trade caravan under the direction of Officer Apolinar Masmela plodded along the Camino Real on its return to Nacogdoches after it had completed a valuable trading expedition to acquire supplies and munitions for Texas. On his way back, Masmela and his subordinates, there's about 15 to 20 pack mules loaded with supplies, started to cross a little creek called the Arroyo Lanana. As they crossed the creek, 12 bandits burst forward from the thick canebrake along the arroyo, fired a salvo of musket fire. They instantly killed one of the Spanish soldiers, wounded two others. Masmela and the remainder of his men swam, or if they're already on the other side, they ran to take cover. All right, they didn't know how many more bandits might be there. And with that, Masmela hurried back to Nacogdoches to report on this latest bandit attack. And the bandits were made off with all the supplies. This was one of 8 documented bandit attacks that occurred in the years 1808 to 1812, or actually 1810 to 1812. It was just a rapid flurry of them. And it made me ponder, why did these events happen in the neutral ground? Is that where it got its reputation for lawlessness? And so as I continued on, I got to get a little organized up here. There's only so much room. So as I continued pondering this, it led me to question, obviously, you know, why were there so many attacks? Is that why the neutral ground had this reputation for lawlessness? But also, what was the significance of this Spanish commercial trade that was going on? You know, why was it going from Texas to Louisiana? I knew that Spanish had royal policies that usually forbid exchange with other nations, and especially the United States in this area where nobody really had any firm control. And it was estimated this trade was worth about $300,000 annually. So in 1812, as you can imagine, that is a substantial sum of money. So as I thought about these questions, it leads me to the background and this kind of geopolitical turmoil that was going on that really undergirded all of these bandit attacks. And so we'll go back to the Louisiana Purchase, and we could go back even further to 1714 with the founding of Natchitoches and 1716 with the founding of Los Adias and the Spanish-French issues, but we're going to jump in 1803. And so with the Louisiana Purchase, the United States gets a deal that they don't expect, right? They're going to Paris to negotiate with the French minister, Charles Maurice de Talleyrand, and what they're offering to purchase is the Isle of Orleans and West Florida. They just want to secure New Orleans so there's a port of deposit on the Mississippi River, and as you can see on the map, the terms kind of change. The French tell Robert Livingston and James Monroe, who are there negotiating, that, well, after, you know, they're not really making any headway, and then one day Napoleon is getting ready, right? He sees another war with Britain is about to start, and so he needs money. So he says, well, you can have the Isle of Orleans and the entire Louisiana territory for approximately $12 million. And so they go, oh, my goodness, we did not have this sort of authority, but we got to do it, right? And a famous quote afterward is, Talleyrand told the American delegation, begin quote, "You have made a noble bargain for yourselves, and I suppose you will make the most of it," end quote. And so what do the Americans start doing, especially Thomas Jefferson? Making the most of it. And so immediately, Jefferson writes, it's about 60 pages, and he entitles it The Limits of Louisiana. And he takes this long historical perspective while entirely neglecting the fact that any Spanish exploration expeditions had been through Florida, Texas, any of that. He conveniently forgets all that, and he highlights French colonization efforts in the 1680s as the beginning of this sort of Louisiana territory. And so as you can see with this map, he claims all of what's considered West Florida, which would be all the way to the Perdido River, and then all the way to the Rio Grande. And he says, Louisiana Purchase is everything. And as you can imagine, Spanish officials were not happy. They're like, come on, you're crazy, right? This is not what the Louisiana territory is. You're way over exaggerating. Besides, we were here before the French. And so they authorize kind of like this rebuttal. And it starts in 1804. And the first friar that they appoint is Padre Melchor de Talamantes, who is, you can actually see up here, Talamantes comes back with the line right here, and he says, well, that's where the Louisiana territory ends, and he highlights the Sabine River, but he says it could be all the way to the Trinity. Well, what happens to him? Immediately fired. So then, the next friar that they hire is Jesus Maria de Puelles. And so he comes back and says, well, I think it's this line. And so he highlights the Sabine River, and then he arrives at he goes up the Red River to somewhere in present-day Oklahoma and then draws it straight up. Fired. So then we get to the Franciscan friar, Padre Jose Antonio de Pichardo, and he defines a line that starts at the Mermentau River, so about 100 miles west of New Orleans, and then it goes up over to Natchitoches, and then he uses what's called the Arroyo Hondo. We'll get to that later. And it goes up to Bayou Pierre, but then it goes at a northeastern angle all the way up to just outside of St. Louis, and then it kind of follows the Missouri River. And he sends all of his findings in an 1812 report that kind of signifies where the Spanish position is on what the Louisiana Territory included. So as you can tell, we have two very different definitions of what this territory included, right? And so, kind of what happens? They say, well, you know, these are high-level diplomats that are arguing over this, and so it falls to the men on the ground to really negotiate this out in live time. And so here are a couple of the American officials that I'll be talking about tonight. William Charles Cole Claiborne was the governor of the Orleans Territory, and then later the state of Louisiana, starting in 1812. And then James Wilkinson, American general, famous double agent, right, Agent 13. And then Dr. John Sibley, who was the Red River Indian agent. Now, all of these men are there on the ground, and a lot of their correspondence provides clues into what is really happening in the neutral ground. Conversely, unfortunately, on the Spanish side, I do not have any portraits, and I have yet to find one, of different Spanish officials. But the most important names are the Commandant General of the Interior Provinces, Nemesio Salcedo, Texas Governor Manuel Salcedo, who was Nemesio's nephew, and then a military officer, Lieutenant Colonel Simón de Herrera. So, as we have this kind of heating up, tensions basically start immediately. And one of the first main, I guess, tensions between the two nations was runaway slaves who would flee American territory into Spanish Texas in the search of freedom. Now, at first, Spain approved this, but there were later complaints, and then the slaves were returned, but this becomes an ongoing issue. A second one was Native American trade and diplomacy. It's been argued fairly persuasively the true power broker in this region was the Catawan tribes, who at any one point had a numerical advantage over either the Americans or the Spanish. So you kind of had, everybody wanted to be on good terms because that could kind of guarantee your power. And then lastly, the frequent military patrols throughout the region, There were several times where troops are arrested, taken back across a river, and then released from both sides. It becomes a flashpoint, and it all culminates kind of in the winter 1805 through the summer of 1806. And in the winter 1805, the Marquis de Casocavo leaves New Orleans on an expedition that he's going to settle this boundary question. And so with him, he takes an experienced cartographer and surveyor, Nicolas de Finials. And so they go down through the coast, and they kind of chart some of these rivers. If you look on the right side, you can see the full chart. But most importantly, what he highlights is the boundary between Texas and Louisiana. He actually highlights the Sabine River. At a certain point, it is marked off and goes over to the Arroyo Hondo, and then along what is Bayou Pierre starts right here, and it runs up almost to modern-day Shreveport, and then it joins back up with the Red River. So this is this borderline he highlights. Conversely, the United States sends a cartographic and surveying expedition up the Red River shortly after, and this is known as the Freeman-Custis Expedition. And surveyor Thomas Freeman and botanist Peter Custis, this was the southern counterpart to the Lewis and Clark expedition, which we all know. It is, you know, a seminal moment in American history. Well, Freeman and Custis, they don't get their due because they get arrested by the Spanish when they reach Spanish Bluff and are sent back down the Red River to Natchitoches. So as soon as this happens, Governor Claiborne hears the news, and he marches from New Orleans to Natchitoches, and along the way he is raising militia units in preparation of this conflict. He sends word to General James Wilkinson, the commanding officer of the U.S. Army at the time, who is also the governor of the Louisiana Territory in 1806. So he has to work his way down the river. Well, as things seem to come to a head, Wilkinson's nowhere to be found. Claiborne has about 1,000 troops with him at, give or take, at Natchitoches. And he and the Spanish, you think, all right, war's about to start. There's no question. He and the Spanish officer, Simón de Herrera, who I mentioned earlier, they parlay. Herrera is actually sick, and so Claiborne sends doctors to Bayou Pierre to help care for Herrera. And the two men kind of come to an agreement, and basically at this point, it's mid-August or late August. There's not much grazing area around, and so the Spanish troops are going to have to withdraw into Texas for grazing area for their horses. So we've got the environment playing a factor here. And Claiborne is like, okay, I think Wilkinson, he's already a month late. I don't know if he's going to ever show up. So Claiborne goes back to New Orleans. He has more pressing matters as governor. And lo and behold, James Wilkinson shows up in October, just a little late. But he knew what he was doing, right? This is a double agent. He's trying to play both sides off of each other. And so Wilkinson shows up. He actually meets with one of Aaron Burr's associates in Natchitoches. And at this point, this is when in history we think that he gives up on his friend Aaron Burr, and we all know the Burr's conspiracy. Well, Wilkinson was pretty evidently in on it too, but he's the guy that says, well, I guess I'm done with this. And so he backs out. At this moment, Wilkinson marches to the Sabine River with his force, and he arrives on the evening of the 3rd of November, and he begins negotiations with the Spanish officer, Herrera. And basically on the 4th and 5th, they come to an agreement on the framework for a deal that is later that what we call the Neutral Ground Agreement. Now on this map, I've drawn it, and basically they declare the area between the Sabine River and the Arroyo Hondo close to Natchitoches right here as outside the sovereign authority of either nation state depending or until an international treaty can be agreed upon. So the neutral ground has now come into existence. And Samuel Davenport, a Spanish trader, offers a much more thorough definition. He defines this neutral ground as, begin quote, the Sabine River in the west, the Gulf of Mexico in the south, from the Gulf up the west bank of the Calcasieu River to its headwaters, then straight north to the Kissatchee Bayou, up the Kissatchee Bayou to the Old River, up the Old River to the Arroyo Hondo, along the Arroyo Hondo directly north to Bayou Pierre, thence northwest along the bayou to the settlement of Bayou Pierre, then in a southwestern direction to the intersection of the Sabine River and the 32nd parallel. That is a long definition. But there's a reason why I wanted to bring it up. because they use waterways as this kind of natural borderline, right? And so they use these waterways to define the limits of this territory. And obviously this map shows how little cartographic knowledge there was of southwestern Louisiana at the time. You can see it's pretty much all blank. And another map places a giant cartouche right here to hide their lack of knowledge. So nobody really knows too much about this area at the time. Well, it's not scientifically cataloged, I guess I should say. But the idea that using environmental borderlines is something that we see today, right? The Rio Grande as the borderline between the United States and Mexico. And as you're about to find out with the neutral ground, environmental borderlines are, everybody can see it, but if you can jump across a creek, I mean, how good is it, you know? So, as we move on, I want to talk a little bit about the environment, the physical environment of this neutral ground region. So largely this is today, we would all know it as a piney woods area. If you get off the banks of the Red River right here, this, you can find patches of fertile soil, but for the most part, it's kind of a sandy soil. There's a lot of, obviously, pine trees, but then there are stands of oak and small grassy openings interspersed between a lot of creeks that are all through this area. And I'm going to skip ahead real quick to show you just how many creeks there are. So this map is a little unclear, but right here, William Darby, who surveyed the area in 1812, he tried to chart all of the waterways, and so you can see how many are there. They're all over the place. So as we go back to here, this is the Arroyo Hondo today, and this is courtesy of Dr. John Evans and Dr. Jim Tiller. They're two geographers, and they co-authored this book, Evolution of the Texas-Louisiana Boundary. Thank you, Dr. John Parker in the back. He gave me a copy earlier. And as you can see, this is what they've identified. This is today, it's called Young's Bayou, but at one point this is an international borderline. It translates to deep creek, so we can imagine this being deeper than it looks. So I don't know how deep that is, but I'm imagining 5 to 8 feet deep. And here is a survey of what's known as the Las Hormigas Grant that was acquired by Samuel Davenport and William Barr in 1805. And right here you can see it is charted, and it actually it shows us what the terrain of the neutral ground looked like. So we have the Sabine River here, and then we have Llanos, these are the dark shaded areas, so these would be grassy openings, and then Encinal, and these would be like oak and pine tree stands that separate the grassy clearings. Now they use this area for ranching, and so you can imagine this probably would have had several hundred cattle and horses spread around it, but it gives us an idea of what this environment looked like as people traveled through it. So as we go, here are some pictures. These are actually from a real estate site that was selling land in the area. And so I figured it would be good to have a visual to see what this sort of environment looks like. And here's a representation of a pack mule. And we will get, this is actually, they used this in they were doing a, kind of like a, what's the right word I'm looking for? They were at the Santa Fe Trail, they were doing a reenactment. And so they were reenacting how they would take pack mules across. And so they used materials that would have been available in the 1820s. So I thought it would be a poignant photo to use to kind of give that visual illustration. So as we get to the neutral ground, we've gone over the, you know, what the physical environment looks like. And now we're going to kind of talk about, well, the Camino Real. All right, I almost went straight past it. The Camino Real was a main road that went from Natchitoches over to Nacogdoches. And it travels right through the middle of the neutral ground. And they actually, this one doesn't include it. William Darby includes it on his map. But it goes straight, it kind of travels southwestern at an angle, and it crosses the Sabine River and then goes to Nacogdoches. On the Texas side, it was about 60 miles, give or take 5 miles. So it would take about 3 days to traverse it. When you reach the neutral ground, it would take about 2 days to get across this neutral ground. And then you'd be in Natchitoches for, you know, 1 to 2, maybe 3 days, depending on how long it took these merchants to acquire the goods. And then you would start the return leg back to Nacogdoches. So a round trip, roughly, we'll estimate it at 16 to 20 days. And all this kind of lays out this environment where all these events are happening. And actually in 1807, Lieutenant Zebulon Pike, who was being escorted back to the United States after being arrested near outside of Santa Fe, well, he got, you know, he never climbs Pike's Peak, right? So then he gets arrested kind of close to Santa Fe. He's taken all the way down to Saltillo. And then after a couple months, the Spanish agree to allow him to return to the United States. So Zebulon Pike actually comes through the neutral ground a few months after its inception. And he provides a few interesting details for us. He identifies people that were living along the Camino Real in the neutral ground and kind of what their livelihoods might look like. So first, when he arrives at the Sabine River, he is actually ferried across by a man named Miguel Crow, and Miguel Crow takes him to his house where he meets everyone there. There was more than 10 people living at the Crow home, and they were engaged in a variety of things, whether it be ranching, but most importantly, he noticed contraband trade. So there were a number of goods there, and so Crow is one of the first people. He's hard to track in the official records because what he is doing is illegal in Spain. It's okay with the United States, but he's got to keep a low profile, and so he successfully does that for the most part. 15 miles further down the road, so we're getting to the ridge line that kind of divides the Calcasieu and Sabine River water basins and Red River. He meets a family called the Falk family, who lived in a shack alongside the road near a small creek. And as he approached about 10 miles further down the road, he approaches the old Spanish mission at Los Adias. And Pike discovered another string of huts constructed by American soldiers when they had gone to the Sabine River to make the agreement in 1806. And what is important is these huts are still standing, and they're going to provide refuge for people who might be considered vagabonds or later bandits, where they can kind of squat on some territory that's in between owners, if we should say. And with all this travel along the Camino Real, by 1811, this is one of my, this is a quote I love from John Sibley. He describes the Camino Real as being, quote, a good carriage road from this place to Mexico, end quote. And it is in the middle of nowhere, there's no upkeep. So what it tells us is the amount of traffic along the Camino Real has picked up tremendously. And I was thinking, you know, you don't really, he describes it as a good carriage road, but there's not very many carriages. We have pack mules that are carrying goods back and forth. We have a lot of livestock. So I can imagine it being a worn down and just well-beaten path. So simultaneous to these developments, we kind of start to have the beginnings of this commercial exchange, this commercial economy that links these regions together. Now we can go back to the 1780s when you have a little bit of Indian trade from Natchitoches up the Red River Valley with Francois Grappe. And then you have Philip Nolan, obviously, who goes into Texas. And Tom and I have talked a lot about Philip Nolan. We both, fascinating character if you don't know anything about him. And he kind of is the most famous person for the horse trade that goes from Spanish Texas back to American Louisiana. And if you've ever wondered how they carved out all the plantations in the Deep South, they got the horses from Texas. So, but cutting to the house of Barr and Davenport. So I mentioned two guys earlier, William Barr and Samuel Davenport. And they started a trading firm in 1798, in which they received a monopoly for the Indian trade in Texas. And so how they would set it up at the time, Spain governed Louisiana and Texas. And so they had a storage house in Nacogdoches and a storage house in Natchitoches and three very large land grants in between for livestock. So we saw the Las Hormigas. They also had the La Nana grant and another five. These are, so one is 4 square leagues, another is 6 square leagues, and the third one is 5 square leagues on the Angeline River in Texas. So a league is about 2.5 miles. So 6 square leagues, we're talking huge amount of property. Now what they do, so once they receive this monopoly, this license, they begin importing goods from Natchitoches over to Nacogdoches that they can trade with Native American tribes in the region. And they will receive payments from the Spanish government to, it's basically a diplomatic exchange. So as long as you are exchanging gifts, there's this element of fictive kinship at play where you can have ties of alliance. So Spain makes sure that they keep this well funded. Now, they also have all these ranches where they can import livestock. Basically, they raise them in Texas, West Louisiana, and then they will drive them across Louisiana to West Florida to New Orleans for sale. So this makes the firm very profitable very quickly. Now in 1806, there's a rearrangement of the partnership. One of the older partners, Luther Smith, dies, and so they kind of dissolve it and then reinstitute it as just Barr and Davenport running the show. And what they begin to do in 1806 is they start to kind of, now they're using American markets. And as you can see right here, there's actually, this is an old town chart from 1823. And this is the layout of the town. And we know from eyewitnesses that a lot of the large warehouses were right here along the river. So I guess right here and right here. And a barge could float up the river and they would throw a plank over, or a couple planks over, and you could literally unload the barge directly into the warehouses. And so this is where merchants would travel into Natchitoches. And there are different variety of different places along the public square. You might have several taverns. The Indian agency that Dr. Sibley ran was somewhere around here. And there was his trading factory was adjacent to it. And actually Fort Claiborne is up around this area. And so you have a whole lot of shenanigans that go down on this square that I've talked about before. And here's the church, so you can imagine the issues. But goods were acquired here and then transported to Spanish Texas. And this kind of leads into some new geopolitical developments. And in 1808, Napoleon invades Spain. So he invades the Iberian Peninsula. And this is going to throw a wrench into the workings of the Spanish Empire. Because now Spain is going to face some uncertainties about supply and importing goods into Mexico, into Veracruz, which are then taken to Mexico City, up to Saltillo, and then up to San Antonio de Bejar, then to Nacogdoches. So you can see there are some issues. It's already a logistical nightmare. And now with the invasion of the Iberian Peninsula, there's another cog in it. And so they're trying to figure out what to do. And the Commandant General Nemesio Salcedo makes some proposals. And he notices that the Samuel Davenport and William Barr have got the right idea. So he asks for an exception to allow trade with American Louisiana. And so goods can be imported to Texas that will satisfy. They can bring guns, munitions to outfit the army, and then they can bring goods to satisfy the citizens. So he views it as a win-win. He also proposes a port be opened in Texas, so that way goods can be shipped in directly from Veracruz up to Texas. But his ideas are, for the most part, they're not approved. They think that it's going to open up Texas too much to foreign influence. And people are reorienting themselves around this market. And then Thomas Jefferson obviously starts his embargo in 1807. And so you're not supposed to trade with any foreign nation for a year and a half. Everybody in Natchitoches they're protesting. They say it's the end of our prosperity. Come on, you got to do something to change this. They constantly write to Governor Claiborne. They complain to the parish judge, John C. Carr. It's falling on deaf ears. They say, this is above us. You know, we can't really do anything. And the situation changes in 1809 when instead of a complete embargo, it is changed to the Non-Intercourse Act. So trade is just prohibited with Great Britain and Napoleon's France. And so all of a sudden, this trade really comes out into the open. There clearly had been a robust contraband trade between the two provinces. But then as soon as the Non-Intercourse Act goes into effect in 1809, all of a sudden officials and traders, they just start coming out in the open and they're walking down the Camino Real. And what's important about this is September 1810, you have Padre Hidalgo, and he starts the Mexican move for independence in central Mexico. And all of a sudden, Spanish Texas is isolated and secluded from the larger New Spain colony. And what the governor and the Commandant General start to do is they look at American Louisiana as the key to maintain authority and supply. And so they also worry about this neutral ground I talked about, because there's a lot of people that are kind of squatting around in there. They did an 1805 census and they found 29 heads of household. So we'll call it about 150 to 200 people living in the area. And they kind of think, you know, these people, it's illegal. Nobody should be here because neither nation has sovereignty over this area. And so they decide that they'll do a joint patrol to clear it out. Now, as military officers, this neutral ground agreement has a sort of honor that they have to abide by. So since James Wilkinson and Simón de Herrera negotiated it and agreed to it, the military officers on both sides are very cautious about abiding by it strictly, I mean, to the letter of the law. They want to abide by it. And they don't want to be seen as being dishonorable or going against the agreement that an officer made. And so what they decide to do is that only joint patrols will be allowed into this contested region, and it must be of equal manpower. And so what they on 7th of July, 1810, Spain, the commandant at Nacogdoches, Francisco Guadiana, writes to the commanding officer at Fort Claiborne, Captain Charles Wollstonecraft, who, this is a cool fact, he is the uncle of Mary Shelley that wrote Frankenstein, and his sister was Mary Wollstonecraft, and she wrote Declaration of Women, it's like Vindication of Women's Rights. It was a 1790s women's rights, I guess, essay? So, yeah. And so anyway, cool connections with him. But Captain Wollstonecraft, he applies to General Wade Hampton, who is stationed close to Baton Rouge, and they're trying to figure out what to do, and they say, okay, well, this is what the agreement was. All right, we'll provide matching manpower. So Wollstonecraft authorizes Lieutenant Augustus Magee, who we're going to talk about a lot here in a little bit. He went to military school in the Northeast. He actually graduated from Phillips Exeter, and he went to the early iteration of West Point as an artillery officer. And he ends up stationed down in Nacogdoches. So Magee leads a party of 12 soldiers. They departed from Fort Claiborne on the 30th of July, 1810. Their patrol lasted about 2 weeks, and the force evicted squatters and destroyed their shacks and property. So those shacks that Zebulon Pike described for us along the Camino Real, this patrol of equal power of Spanish and American soldiers is going to go through. They're going to evict everybody. They're going to escort them out. They gave them maybe an hour to get their belongings. Then they escort them out. They burn down the shack, and then they kind of go their own way. What's interesting is Dr. John Sibley, he lamented the fact that the removal of these squatters and these citizens opened the territory to banditry. Begin quote, since that honest, industrious settlement of people at Los Adias was broken up by order of our own and the Spanish government last summer, bandits have moved in and taken their place, end quote. So this patrol, while they thought they were, you know, evicting these potential banditti from this area, what Sibley argues is that they enabled the very bandits that they sought to remove, because they removed the good people, industrious people. Yes, they might have been squatting illegally, but they weren't robbing anybody. So, I mean, I can understand his, I get where he's coming from with that, I guess. So, Governor Manuel Saucedo then authorized the first significant trade caravan to travel from Nacogdoches to Nacogdoches for supplies. And so he authorized Officer Josef Rossi to travel to Nacogdoches to purchase arms and munitions to the amount of 20,000 pesos. And Saucedo identified a man in Nacogdoches named Felix Trudeau, who was a former Spanish colonial official, as kind of his local contact, who he could work with to acquire the supplies and bring them back. Apparently, Rossi's trade venture was very successful. He got back, took all the supplies that they needed, a lot of guns and powder and musket balls. And so then, about every 3 weeks, a Spanish trade caravan would traverse the neutral ground to Nacogdoches and then return. So for 3 months, you can imagine the merchants in Nacogdoches were ecstatic. All of a sudden, they were getting some major investment, and a lot of it was silver specie from the Spanish mines in Mexico. So they were just, I mean, they had to be on the edge of their seat, just tickled to death with this economic investment going on. So this trade continues until January 1811, and this is really when the revolutionary flames from central Mexico first reached Texas. And this is what we call the Las Casas Rebellion. And this is the first time that Texas was an independent republic. It only lasted for a little over a month and a half, maybe 2 months, but it was independent nonetheless. I fooled everybody with a trivia question when I was doing that one. They don't teach that one in schools. But by the end of the month, in January 1811, John Sibley reported that, begin quote, intercourse with Spanish Texas ceased, and I have no new information on the events in Mexico, end quote. Normally, Sibley's house on this public square right here, he becomes a very good informant because everybody that comes to town will come to the different merchant houses all along here, and so he kind of has eyes on everybody, not to mention his own informal information network. So he's a really good eyewitness for when this trade happens because he always writes about it. He was an ambitious individual, always on the lookout for how to make it bigger and better. And that's probably why he was jealous of the merchants. And so at one point he jumps into it, but unfortunately he has some bad timing, as we'll talk about later. By March 1811, a conservative counter-rebellion actually recaptured San Antonio de Bejar and pushed disaffected rebels into western Louisiana, into our neutral ground. So the survivors from this Las Casas Rebellion are going to become some of the first bandits that we see in the neutral ground. By February even, so late February, John Sibley writes, begin quote, the belt of country between this town and the River Sabine called neutral ground has become a harbor for thieves, robbers, and murderers to an alarming degree. I was yesterday out with a coroner's inquest on the body of a man, a citizen of the United States, who was found dead, who had been robbed and murdered by them a few miles from this town, end quote. This is going to be the changing of the character of the neutral ground. Before, there was always a little bit of unease or maybe anxiety over this area, but now the term wilderness begins to be used. It's kind of like this uncivilized place where obviously characters with malintentions would hide and take refuge. And so our first robbery after this reinstitution of power in Nacogdoches occurs in June 1811. 17 Spaniards arrived in Nacogdoches with between 15,000 to 20,000 pesos. We just have a loose estimate, working on narrowing down the accounting information in these documents. It's a little confusing sometimes with the adding, subtract, you know, working on that part. But they arrived in Nacogdoches, and they acquired their goods, and then they set out to return to Nacogdoches. While in the neutral ground, a party of 30 bandits attacked the caravan as it crossed the Sabine River, headed to Spanish territory. What's interesting about this is that they attacked them at the Sabine, which was, Spain had instituted a guard about 2 miles across after the river. And so they attack, they get all the supplies, and it was very strategic. You attack them at a waterway, especially a deep waterway, where the troops guarding or escorting this caravan would have to kind of separate. Some of them get across, so that way they can help the others reach the other side, and whenever they would, that's when the bandits would attack. So they would attack people already trying to cross the river. I can only imagine the surprise and fear of the last guy in the escort, because he was the most exposed. You want to be the guy leading the way, right? So you can be on the other side, on the other bank. But they attack the caravan successfully. They capture all the goods, and then I guess the bandits just had a heyday and started celebrating. Unbeknownst to them, the Spanish troops hurried to the forward detachment that was across the river. They rendezvoused with them, rallied together, and then turned around in pursuit of the bandits. And we know that the Spanish counterattack, begin quote, killed a John Villars of Kentucky, wounded Taylor of Georgia, and took prisoner Middleton of Virginia, end quote. So they successfully caught up to the bandits and obviously gave them retribution that they did not expect. Well, it's important. This is one of the few instances where we actually have the names of these bandits identified. For the most part, these are nameless, faceless people. We just know them as bandits who might darken their face or jump out of a cane break, and that's kind of the end of them. But here we have names and places of individuals. And it shows, it's kind of highlighting the beginnings of this Anglo-American migration to this area in Nacogdoches. Around this time, the population of the entire district is about 2,800 people, with 51% enslaved, and so 49% free, and a very small percentage of that are Anglo-Americans. But we've got three bandits killed, and they are certified as Anglo-Americans. So they are going to be the ones that start causing the most mischief. But they are not the only people that are working as bandits. At any one point in time, it might be Spanish Texans, it might be Native Americans, it might be escaped slaves. You name it, they probably participated in it. But this attack worried the parish judge, John Carr. He did not know what to do. Since it occurred in the neutral ground, he knew that the agreement said that they did not have civil or judicial authority to arrest and charge anyone in this area. And he thought that if the district court took cognizance of the robbery and it failed to prosecute them, then that would be just the end of prosperity, but it also set the precedent for how events in that area could be conducted without fear of retribution or arrest. So the bandits clearly move frequently between Natchitoches and the neutral ground. In all probability, they would hang out in all of our tavern area and on the public square, scout out a Spanish trade caravan as it came to town and acquired goods, disperse into the neutral ground to a certain rendezvous point, and then plan their attack in conjunction with how the caravan was traveling, how many soldiers it had. If it was a larger group of soldiers, they would probably wait for a larger body of water. Smaller group, then they would just take advantage of probably the first deep creek they came to. But the important thing is all eight attacks that we have documented occurred at water crossings. So the physical environment almost added a sense of possibilism to what these bandits contrived to do. And also the built environment of the Camino Real dictated where these Spanish trade caravans would be. A trade caravan would not wander aimlessly through the forest of this neutral ground right here. It would follow the Camino Real, that's the beaten path. So we have set parameters for where these events can take place. Now, Governor Claiborne heard Carr's worries about the death of prosperity, and he instructed Carr, begin quote, "If robbery occurred east of the Sabine River, then you cannot do wrong in arresting the offenders. The question of jurisdiction can best be determined by the court," end quote. And so what Claiborne is, all these officials, Spanish and American, they both realized the neutral ground's existence outside of sovereignty of either nation undermines both of their authority, and it kind of allows these bandits to operate. You know, there are no military posts in this area, so you have about roughly 50 miles of terrain that is, you know, unprotected. And it did not take long for the next attack to occur. By July 1811, John Sibley noted, "Another party of 15 armed Spaniards arrived to trade at Natchitoches less than 1 month after the previous robbery. This time, an armed escort waited for them in the neutral ground to try to discourage against any depredations against the caravan." They make it back. They had to be on edge the entire time. I can only imagine it was probably the same soldiers that traveled over the first time. And so they were probably awaiting another attack. And fortunately for them, this time they get through. So, sorry, that was not the next one. That was a pause in them. In early September 1811, Mexican revolutionaries Bernardo Gutierrez de Lara and Jose Menchaca arrive in Natchitoches. And these are going to be the first representatives of this movement for independence in Mexico. Both had fought for the insurgents and had been appointed as agents to travel to the United States and try to drum up military and financial support. The two men arrived in Natchitoches being chased by a Spanish patrol. And what I find ironic about this, when they're found kind of destitute in the woods, a little bit northwest of Natchitoches. But the patrol that went out to find these men was also, they also had an additional objective. Begin quote, "Search for robbers who committed a robbery of three persons near Los Adias last Sunday night of merchandise from three Spaniards, one of whom is missing," end quote. So we have got another bandit attack mixed in with the arrival of these revolutionary guys. And the next robbery is soon right after. It gets almost redundant. You think I'd be making up these, you know, it's like every month we have a bandit attack. November 1911, a party of bandits robbed another Spanish trade caravan in the vicinity of Arroyo La Nana. A Spanish trader had left Natchitoches with about 15 mules loaded with merchandise to venture across the neutral ground. As he attempted to cross the Arroyo La Nana, 19 bandits robbed him of all his possessions. A patrol of 25 men attempted to catch the bandits, but they failed to find the culprits. And so here we are, November 1811, and it's almost like a wash, rinse, repeat, right? Just continue. It's just clockwork happening. What's interesting is that all of these attacks occurred after the caravans left Natchitoches. They never occurred on the way in. So there's some rationale that we can think about that. In this area, Spanish silver specie would probably be, until they started trading heavily in Natchitoches, it would be in rather limited supply. And so if you attack a trade caravan in the neutral ground and you capture all the silver with it, and then you go back to trade it, everybody's going to know what you did. Instead, they would take the goods, which could then be traded to various Native American tribes or squatters in exchange for other things. And what goods might they take, or what goods are being purchased? We know that textiles, arms, powder, musket balls, even sewn gowns, needles, thimbles, tools, these were all merchandise that would be captured from these trade caravans and then almost taken and then bartered off in exchange for other goods. So it's very interesting when and where these attacks take place. So now we'll get back to the wash, rinse, repeat. December 1811, Bernardo Montero, responding to these robberies, he decided to come up with a plan to better guard these trade caravans. He wanted to ensure their safety on the Camino Real, so he proposed that a full-time guard be placed at the crossing of the Sabine River. However, it seems unclear how often this guard was placed and how many soldiers were sent there. We do know that at approximately the same time, actually in the same week, the revolutionary I told you about, Jose Menchaca, organized a filibuster expedition. So basically they send Bernardo Gutierrez de Lara to Washington, D.C. to see if he can get official American support. And Menchaca raises a filibuster expedition, and their first goal is to go back and take Natchitoches. Menchaca, and he organizes filibuster. It's unclear how many men are there, but by the time they get to the Sabine River, he believes that it's destined for failure. He abandons the men. This filibuster just kind of dissipates. There's no attack on Natchitoches. But now we have more bandits in the neutral ground. So it's a recipe for, another bandit attack, right? 2nd of January, 1812, it occurs. And so at that time, a Spanish trade caravan had arrived in Natchitoches, taking 15 to 20 pack mules back, is attacked, and there's one Spanish soldier killed. But this time we have more forceful action taken by the merchants of Natchitoches. They believe that by this point, we've had so many bandit attacks, every time it's an official Spanish trade caravan, it's pretty much attacked on its return. They're gonna cut us off. You know, we like this money, we need them to keep coming back. So they believe that the commerce of the region is teetering on the edge of destruction. They beg Governor Claiborne to take steps to eradicate the commission of these robberies. The robberies had become so frequent that no one felt safe to travel on the highway back to Texas. And then they send, in this memorial, they have a very, it's a very poignant quote that I really like, so I'll begin it here, it's a little long. But the many depredations committed by a number of desperate banditti who have assembled in that quarter, allured by the prospect of plunder and the hopes of impunity, the memorialists will content themselves with stating to Your Excellency that on the 2nd of January, this was the attack on the road leading from the Sabine to Bayou Pierre. This caravan was attacked by 30 men in number with their faces blacked and otherwise disfigured. They fired upon them, killed one man, wounded several, one it is supposed mortally so, and robbed them of all their horses, mules, baggage, and about $6,000 in specie. They ended the passage with another statement to Claiborne, and they said, the civil authority cannot force their services for the necessary length of time to apprehend or remove the banditti from the almost uninhabited country which they infest, end quote. They were begging Governor Claiborne to please talk to General Hampton, get an official military patrol to go in the area and clear it out. Governor Claiborne then reached out to Hampton, who said to follow the protocol as conducted in 1810. And so Wade Hampton contacts the commandant of Nacogdoches, proposes a joint patrol occur with utmost speed. The commandant, Francisco Guadiana, says he cannot act immediately, but he will forward it to the commandant general, Nemesio Salcedo. In the meantime, we get to the opening anecdote that I had, where Apolinar Masmela was attacked in February 1812. Masmela's attack would be the final one before this joint patrol would go into the neutral ground. And on it, I guess you could say they thought that they were giving the bandits what they deserved, but they probably got the wrong people. So Lieutenant Colonel Zebulon Pike at this time is dispatched to Nacogdoches to organize this patrol. He had received instructions that he should contact the Spanish authority, but if Spain could not conduct the patrol with speed, he should move ahead and then tell them they can conduct a similar patrol at a later time. So Pike authorized Lieutenant Augustus Magee and Lieutenant Montgomery and 40 men to enter the neutral ground and clear it out of bandits. According to John Sibley, who kind of despises all these official military men to an extent, he believed that the patrol behaved in a manner similar to, begin quote, General Taro's expedition to the Vendée, end quote. The patrol's brutality toward the individuals it encountered in the neutral ground astounded Sibley and others. Lieutenant Magee captured 14 prisoners along with, begin quote, horses, mules, hogs, chickens, hens, women's gowns, petticoats, scissors, thimbles, finger rings, shawls, blankets, money, guns, and rifles, end quote. Magee stripped them, tied them to trees, whipped them, burnt them with chunks of coal to make them confess to their wrongdoings, to their acts of violence. And Sibley poignantly said, his methods were not toward bandits, they were toward squatters who were living in these huts along the road. Magee arrested the 14 men, he took them for trial at the district court. Five were immediately released, so nine go to trial. Of the nine, one was Miguel Crow, who we knew from Lieutenant Pike's travels earlier. Miguel Crow and his family were released at the trial. But two men were convicted. And the two men that were convicted were sentenced to 7 years hard labor and 100 lashes. So these guys not only got burnt by charcoal, then they got to court and got 100 lashes immediately afterward. What's fascinating, though, is their legal defense. They argued that as per terms of the neutral ground agreement, no nation had sovereign control over this strip of land. Therefore, no laws could be applied to them. The court rejected their argument and said that Louisiana statehood in 1812 had removed the neutral ground. The declaration of the western border, now being the Sabine River, extended judicial authority and they could be charged and convicted of such crimes. And with that, it was the final bandit attack on a Spanish trade caravan until the Magee-Gutierrez expedition, which we know our guy Magee. I'm going to try to wrap this up real quick. Lieutenant Augustus Magee resigned his commission shortly after this patrol, and he joined up with Bernardo Gutierrez de Lara in this filibuster expedition that was being planned in Nacogdoches. A special agent sent from Washington, D.C., William Shaler, helped organize and supply the expedition. And they organized several hundred volunteers from Mississippi Territory to New Orleans, up to Nacogdoches from Tennessee, Kentucky. All these men, they had sent out post flyers advertising to participate in this filibuster. And so in early August 1812, the patrol sets out, or this filibuster sets out to go capture Nacogdoches. Along the way, a poor Spanish officer, Isidro de la Garza, was taking this final trade caravan into Natchitoches. He had over 60 pack mules with 100 armed men escorting this caravan. I'm sure that he believed we had enough firepower and enough men to prevent, you know, any attack from being successful. Unfortunately, he ran into a filibuster at the Sabine River with several hundred armed men and even a couple cannons. So De La Garza turned tail to run, but the filibuster caught this group with Samuel Kemper at the lead, caught up to the rear elements of the caravan, and the rest of the filibusters caught up, and they captured Natchitoches on the 12th of August, 1812. So the final attack on a Spanish trade caravan actually signified the beginning of the Magee-Gutierrez expedition that would eventually create the second Free Republic of Texas in 1813, before being kicked out of the state in August 1813. So it was about 5 months. And as Texans say, they say the first one was 1836. I'm sorry, it was not. It was a lot earlier. So with that, I will end. I've got more details. If you got any questions, I would love to answer them. Thank you so much for your attention and attendance. And I'd like to thank Tom for inviting me and all the guys in the back, Bob, Kevin, and Aaron, I think. So thank y'all so much.
Any questions, comments, protests? This is a library, you can disagree.
Where were those lashings in 1812? Was that in Natchitoches?
They was tried in Rapides. They did not want to do the trial in Natchitoches because they believed that the bandits had too many friends and connections. So they had the trial in Rapides, and unfortunately, all of my documentation from that has to be from secondhand eyewitnesses, because the Rapides, all the records from the courthouse in Rapides were burned in the Civil War.
So the Rapides posed Alexandria?
Yes.
Yeah. One more question.
Yes.
One more question. In 1805 or 1806?
Yes.
When there was almost a conflict between Spain and America, Governor Claiborne sent his brother, Ferdinand Claiborne, up the Red River to Natchitoches with a force. Mm-hmm. How close did that come to a military conflict?
I would say in August. The Freeman Custis expedition arrives back in Natchitoches. I believe the correct date is the 30th of June. And Claiborne's brother, you are right, he arrives before William does. William takes the road up through Opelousas and Attakapaw and then up to Natchitoches. And I would say in mid-August, in late August, it seems like it was, if Wilkinson had been there and wanted to start the conflict, I think that war would have popped off right then. But since Wilkinson's not there, to me it seems apparent that Governor Claiborne, there's that tension and that rivalry between the civil authority and the military officers, where they're not going to let him command an army, and the commanding officer in Natchitoches basically won't move until Wilkinson or another general is there to kind of take the lead. So since Spain didn't attack, they kind of hold off. But I would say at that moment, you could flip a coin and it could happen, or it could have happened. But after that, I think it cools off pretty quickly. So by the time Wilkinson gets there, it seems to be pretty much de-escalated.
Going back to the Louisiana Purchase in 1803, it sounds like France sold the U.S. something they either did not own or control. The de facto was that Spanish military and Spanish settlers really seemed to control the area. I didn't hear you talk about French interaction with the U.S. at all here.
Yes. So this is the fun fact. And Spain controls Louisiana basically from 1762-63. It's after the conclusion of the Seven Years' War. They control Louisiana from that point until basically 1803 or 18 December 1803, when the United States officials arrive in New Orleans. It's the Treaty of San Ildefonso in 1800. Is a secret agreement where Spain sends Louisiana back to France, but France never actually sends colonial officials to run the colony until after the purchase. So Pierre Lasso, that comes down as the French minister to govern Louisiana, arrives maybe a couple, I don't remember his exact date of arrival, but I want to say it's almost simultaneous to the purchase agreement in Paris. So that would be spring, or like late spring of 1803. And so they never move. Spanish officials continue to govern the territory. In Natchitoches in April 1804, this will sum it up for you. The American detachment of troops under Captain Edward Turner, they arrived to take official possession of Natchitoches, and it was still being governed by Spanish officials. So at 10 a.m. that morning, they had a ceremony to transfer power from Spain to France. And then at 11 a.m., they had the ceremony to transfer power from France to the United States. So Spain was still governing Louisiana up to the purchase, and most of the transfers of power are from Spain to France, France to America, and all within a couple hours. So it's kind of a fascinating tidbit, even though they technically owned, or they had Louisiana back for 3 years.
Any other questions, comments, or protests? Why don't you join me in just a second? I'm going to ask a few questions. And I did not realize until I had invited Jackson to speak to us. When he comes back, he'll be Dr. Pearson. But I did not realize how these bandits had undermined Spanish authority. We were always taught in school that it was, Father Hidalgo and revolutionaries occurring in Spain, in Mexico, which undoubtedly there were, but I didn't realize the role of the bandits in undermining Spanish authority in Texas. Is this new research, or no one cared, or why was I not taught that?
I would say that it's probably a combination of, like I said, the earlier research done in the 1940s, J. Villasana Haggard, he was actually a translator at the Bayard Archives in San Antonio. And so he wrote his dissertation. He talks about these bandit attacks, but he doesn't make any sort of historical argument per se. He's writing a narrative history. And so nobody's really analyzed where these attacks occurred. What was this commercial economy that was developing and then quickly, stomped out by the bandit attacks? And, I think they play a much larger influence in why historical events transpired the way that they did.
Undermining Spanish authority.
Yeah.
At what point, and this is kind of an esoteric question, at what point was there possibility of Spanish Empire, American trade prospering and resolving their differences without all these conflicts?
It's an interesting question. There were a lot of, Nemesio Salcedo lays out, he has this document, it's December 1808, basically after France invades the Iberian Peninsula. And he lays out a series of suggestions for how Texas could be made stronger. And what it really looks like is that the viceroy, he wants Texas as a buffer zone, which is kind of a common historical argument, right? They view Texas as this buffer zone. But Nemesio Salcedo and Governor Manuel Salcedo see opportunity for prosperity and like a strengthened colony that could really entrench Spanish authority. But their ideas never receive approval. So he wanted to open up trade with American territory, open up a port for the direct importation and exportation of goods. And he proposed, obviously, strengthening garrisons and improving, building more forward, like military posts. So he wanted to build them up to the Sabine and through the neutral ground if Spain would have that territory. So it's this whole list of ideas. I think they really just get lost in the shuffle of the chaos of that period. And so none of them are approved. He never receives financial support, really. The colony is always underfunded, under-garrisoned, and so it's, the work that the Spanish officials do and the officers is phenomenal because they're always undermanned. They're always have limited supplies. And so it's kind of remarkable what they actually do with that.
since this affects Allen, Texas history, but the Philip Nolan, the last Philip Nolan expedition came through possibly that Collin County. And the only reason we know that is because one of the few survivors of the Nolan expedition was a Peter Bean, Peter Ellis Bean. And he mentioned in his memoirs that we traveled along the Red River and up to the upper reaches of the Trinity River. Well, that could be the East Fork, if, in which case they would have come through Allen or nearby. Or that could have been the Elm Fork, which means Denton, or they could have gone over to West Fork. Yeah, so he wasn't that precise. So we don't know exactly, but if that's the case, they might have come up the Red River through Collin County, and then, I think his exact words, then we went in a southwesterly path. Why, if Nolan was bringing Spanish horses to Louisiana and Mississippi, which were starving for horses, and by the way, those of you from Allen, there's a Mustang Creek, there's a Mustang School, Mustang is everywhere in Allen, Texas, and there's reason for that. Mustangs, when the pioneers arrived, Mustang horses were everywhere. They were as common as Johnson grass. Why were the Spaniards so horrified that he was taking, because I'm sure he was bribing somebody in Spain or the Spanish Louisiana. Why were they so horrified about him coming to get horses and taking them to back to Mississippi and Louisiana?
So Spanish basically governed their colonies with non-importation agreement between the viceroyalties. And so Texas would have been divided where it would have been oriented to San Antonio de Bejar and then down to Saltillo, down to Mexico City as it worked its way down the chain. And Louisiana was oriented to New Orleans. Now, looking back, we can see that, you know, like geographically speaking, it's a lot quicker to get to New Orleans than it is to get all the way down to Saltillo and Mexico City. So it seems that they probably could have reoriented how they were governing the colonies. What's interesting with Nolan is he's not the only person that was in on the trade. He just is the most famous historically. So there are a number of other contraband Mustangers that are collecting horses and taking them out. They required a special passport that had to be issued by both governors. So the Louisiana governor and the Texas governor would have to approve it. And also the final, early on when Spain, I can't remember exactly what year, but they declare all Mustangs Los Mustaños, which Jack Jackson has a great book on that. But they declare them the king's property. And so if you are exporting horses, you have to have the proper paperwork or else you are stealing from the king. And so that is one reason why it just kind of shakes out like that. But Nolan's not the only one, and there are people that are constantly doing it. If you look at the archives, it is just report after report of trying to catch this contrabander and rarely successful, but they're always sending out patrols trying to hunt them down.
I'm convinced that probably the Native Americans had, for a price, told the Spanish authorities where they were hiding because, there was no helicopters, surveillance. I mean, Texas was big. So, but nevertheless, they were caught by the Spanish government. I think where their big problem was they started shooting instead of surrendered. But anyways, question. Okay, there's a question. Let me bring the mic to you. It gives me exercise for one thing, plus so the audience can hear your question. And the virtual audience. We have a virtual audience now. Thanks to the pandemic, we have an in-person audience and a virtual audience.
So it was just two thoughts that I wanted to relate to you and see what you thought about this. In Natchitoches, up until, I guess, the 1765 or so, when France handed over to Spain, Louisiana, I think from one Bourbon cousin in France to the Bourbon cousin in Spain, then both Texas and Louisiana at that time were Spanish. There was no longer any French, Spanish kind of contraband, kind of under the table trade between Natchitoches and Spanish Texas at that point. So a lot of the wealthy people in Natchitoches at that point started to move down the river, as I was telling you, and move to agriculture. And so Natchitoches sort of lost its trade post status. So was it, this is what I wanted you to comment on. So was it with the Louisiana Purchase when it became American? Is that really when Natchitoches began to like have a resurgence as a trading post again? So that's the first thought. The second is, when the border, the Arroyo Hondo, there's some dispute about which creek that actually was. I'm sure you know about that. And I was telling you about Dr. Pete Gregory at NSU. And people think it goes through Hagewood, which is about halfway between Los Adias and Natchitoches. But Young's Bayou actually makes like an arc, and this is well above the Calcasieu headwaters, you know, north of that. So it makes an arc and it goes up to what's now called Sibley Lake, which is a 20th century, you know, reservoir. And then it comes down between the dam at Sibley Lake into the Old River, which before the 1760s was the main bed of the Red River at that time. And it runs along the Old River like you described, how it came up through the Kasachi Creek up to the Old River, and then Young's Bayou. So I just wanted to make the comment that Pete Gregory thinks it's the Young's Bayou part right by the Old River, which is like 2 miles outside of where Natchitoches is on the Cane River, as opposed to in Hagewood, which is like the arc of it that comes around, which is a huge difference in mileage.
Yes. What we do know is that it was about, they estimated it 2.5 leagues from Natchitoches. And so with that in mind, we can say that it was probably translating it to miles, we'd say that it's 5 to 6 miles away. Now, unfortunately today, and this is, I'm sure they can, we will be able to debate this to the end of time, with how the creation of Sibley Lake and how rivers change course over, and bayous change course over time, we may never, like, it could be the one that's 2 miles away today and just has changed. With the creation of Sibley Lake, that entire area now looks completely different. There are several persuasive arguments both ways for it. I do agree, it's much closer to Natchitoches though than what, it's not 10 or 12 miles away. It's within 5 miles. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, it would. Yes. Yeah. And that's what is so, fascinating because, De Finials and the Marquis de Caso Calvo, when they travel back, so they travel along the coast, but then they come back through Natchitoches on the Camino Real. And so he's one of the first people whenever the boundary dispute is going on, and he makes that point to draw that line right there. So that's why it's such a fascinating map, because he's probably the only one that really takes significance with where the Arroyo Hondo is. And so I would agree with you. It's very close to the city. And that's why the Fort Claiborne, all the troops basically end up on garrison duty after the neutral ground agreement, because they can only go a couple miles outside of town, and that's the limit of American authority. And so they become the biggest drunks and fighters on the public square. So they all protest to get the fort kicked out of town. But to your first point with the trade, they still prohibited, even when Spain controlled Louisiana and Texas, they still prohibited intercourse between the two colonies unless you had the proper paperwork. So Pablo Lafitte, he has a pretty famous case, and he's arrested a couple times for contraband because he was in the deerskin trade, and he would travel to Texas and trade for deerskins and then bring them back to Louisiana. And so he's actually arrested in the 1780s, I want to say 1787, but I'm not sure. And so he's arrested for that exact trade. And that is Sophie Burton, who wrote Colonial Natchitoches. And she has that great economic breakdown of how Natchitoches reorients its economy right at that time, 1790. I mean, it all goes to cotton. And so it's early on. And so that's where there is a resurgence for merchants, but it's after the Americans come back. Because I think a lot of the best land is already, it's already owned and under cultivation. And so they don't see kind of like an avenue to get into the cotton unless they buy somebody's land.
Can you repeat the question for the audience, a virtual audience.
Okay. The question was if I brought up the Lafitte family. So the question was if Pierre and Jean Lafitte, they started operating illegal slave trade where there was no, the U.S. outlawed the Atlantic slave trade and the importation of foreign slaves in 1808. And so the question, Lafitte basically sets up this illegal slave trade outpost on the Sabine River. And so the question was, how far up into the neutral ground did that trade go? Is that, does that sum it up right? So a lot of it was still oriented toward New Orleans. There are some cases of it going up the Calcasieu and then hopping over. But most of it, even on the Sabine River, they would go along the Opelousas Road and just kind of travel on the southern part until they still kind of go through Donaldson. Like they do pop up on the, they might pop up on the Red River and then they sail straight down. And I know it's fascinating. It's William Davis, I believe, is the historian. He wrote the book on the Lafittes. And so he has some of the old, and this is what I wish we could see, because they would put up posters in New Orleans that would announce a slave sale on the Sabine River. And it would have like, basically it'd have like a location. It would just very simple stuff. It would have like, you know, Rio Sabine, and it'd have a number. And so that was supposed to be code for where to meet on the Sabine River to acquire slaves. And so that was how he would advertise it. But you don't really see too much of that in Natchitoches. Actually, what I found interestingly enough is the overland domestic slave trade coming from Kentucky, Tennessee, Virginia. There are a lot of caravans that come into Natchitoches starting in 1810, and then they kind of end with the War of 1812, that whenever, you know, and then in 1817 they show up again, and you'll have slave traders come in with 20 or so slaves and sell them in Natchitoches. And so that's where Natchitoches kind of gets more oriented, is there instead of on the coast. I hope that answers your question.
See, that was one of the questions I was going to ask. It seemed like a lot of this, of course, looking back, you know, it's such an incredible evil thing to think of people selling people. But it seems like a lot of this was funneled by the slave trade.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the cotton economy, and it's based on slave labor. And so Natchitoches becomes one of the, premier cotton producing areas until, I guess, Rapides and Alexandria eventually overtake it with production, but it's not for till the 1820s, would you say? Is that fair? 1830s? Yeah, Civil War. The cotton, that's the dominant economy. And everybody that moves down is trying to figure out how to make enough money to invest in buying land to create a plantation and start cultivating cotton. And so they look at the Spanish trade, the Indian trade. They'll go all the way up the Red River, get deerskins, and come back and hope they made enough to buy a plot of land and start producing cotton. So it's like everybody kind of gets focused on that one venture.
Any last minute questions? I'm going to leave you with a little thought. Besides the use of meets and bounds in real estate, and the Spanish use of meets and bounds still prevalent today, I'd like to leave you with one thought. One of our legacies from the Spanish Empire is Texas is a one-bite state. You know what that is? If your dog bites somebody, they can't do anything to you. This is in Texas. If your dog bites somebody twice, you better have a good attorney. Texas is a one-bite state, and it goes back to the Spanish Empire. It's part of our Spanish legacy. And there's more, but that I was ending up on a lighthearted. But it is part of case law. And many people have tried to sue their neighbors because the dog bit them. And I'm sorry, this is the first documented case that your dog has bitten somebody. Sorry. Any last-minute questions, comments, protests? This has been just absolutely fascinating. And thank you so much, Jackson. He came all the way from Fort Worth, I believe. And
thank you, everybody, for showing up. I hope you all enjoyed it. And to all the viewers, thank you for watching. And hopefully we'll have more future views. So for future viewers, y'all too.